This is Pastor Mike Brenner of Abba Christian Center in Slippery Rock. First of all, I'd like to extend an invitation to you if you're in the Slippery Rock area to come to our service Sunday 10:30 at the Slippery Rock Park building. And also, as you're ready to enter in and listen to the Word of God regarding this service, I want to share with something with you I believe will be of great help to you. Everything we do at Abba Christian Center is in the context of intimacy with Jesus Christ. God wants you to know this. He died not just so you could have eternal life, but that His life will become your life. What do I mean by that? 2 Peter 1:3-4 says, He's called you to partake of His glory in virtue of His divine nature. It means that the very faith of God, He wants it to be in you. Romans 12:3, Galatians 2:20, the very love of God that caused Him to die for you. He wants that same love to be in you. Romans 5:5. He wants the very life intrinsic to His own being, because you're His literal child. He wants His life, glory to God, to become your life. He wants His faith to be your faith, His love to be your life, His wisdom be your wisdom, His compassion to be your compassion. You say, that's almost too good to be true. I'm going to tell you something. Jesus Christ is too good to be true for your mind. That's why He's given you a heart to believe. I trust that with your heart, you'll enter into the message today knowing that He died, that His life might become your life. It's normal. It becomes a normal reality in our lives. So I want to share on, let's start with Isaiah chapter 6. We want to share on the reality of the Word of God as a vision. Ken Hagin shared this message, and it really impacted me, and I really been meditating on it and adding some things to it, and just the Word of God as a vision. And then we're going to, I tell you, when we're in worship, man, that just so strong, you know, the love of God, you know, being our life. How many know you can't laugh yourself? Amen? Glory to God. You can't not laugh yourself. The Bible tells us to crucify ourselves. You can't crucify yourself without Jesus. Amen? You can get the first nail in, but that second one's kind of tough. You know what I'm saying? You can't crucify yourself. You can't laugh yourself. Our life is in Him. Amen? Glory to God. I mean, just like, you know, the blood flows in your veins to give you life. Amen? Honestly, in Jesus, hallelujah, His anointing flows in us. And that is our life. And I love that song that, you know, it says, His presence, amen, glory to God, is heaven. Woo, hallelujah. Heaven is in us, amen. Glory to God. So the Word of God is heaven in the sense that it's Jesus. In the beginning was the Word was with God, the Word was God. John 1:1, John 1:14, the Word became flesh. If we're going to win in the midst of battle, and that's where the blessing is, we don't run from the battle, amen, we run to the battle. Glory to God. And you might as well run to the battle, because if you don't run to the battle's going to run to you. Amen? So you might as well get a head start. Amen? When David was fighting Goliath, Goliath was walking to him. David was walking to him, and then David said did something very interesting, very simplistic. He ran to the battle line and got a head start on Goliath. Amen? Don't wait for the enemy to come to you. Go to him. Amen. Glory to God. So in Isaiah chapter 6, it shares of a vision, glory to God, that Isaiah had. It says, in the year that Uzziah died. And here's a key to the whole passage. Uzziah was a king. He was a very good king. He was good to the house of God. And it was a time of blessing. And he died. And man, and somebody else was taken over. It wasn't so good. And it looked like they were going to go downhill because he was in power in the natural. But God comes this in a year that King Uzziah died. He said, I also saw the Lord, woo, sitting on a throne, high and lifted up, and His train filled the temple. Glory to Jesus. Woo. And above it stood the seraphim, and He tells about the angels. And then it says that in verse 3, and one cried out to another, holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. Ooh, glory to God. Interesting enough, when Pastor Kathy shared on Psalm 25, it says, who is the King of Glory? Who is the King of Glory? And there's been books and volumes, and I've written about who is the King of Glory. Nobody can come up with an answer. And the bottom line is in Psalm 25, it says the King of Glory is Yahweh Shehabath, the Lord of hosts. It tells you. Amen. And that's the number one name in the context of prevalency in the Bible regarding the names of God. Yahweh Shehabath, the Lord who fights for you, the Lord of hosts, the Lord who is militantly fighting for you. There's almost 248 times, I believe, in the Old Testament that name is shared. Why? Because when you love somebody and you are the God of glory, amen, you will fight against the enemy so your glory can be released. Amen? Glory to God. So when the enemy comes in like a flood, God raises up a standard of glory. Today, I tell you, the presence of his glory was awesome. And it's here today, even now. So I want to encourage you, glory to God. So it says the angels, you know, the doorposts were shaken. Wow. And the angels were crying out one unto another, glory, glory, glory. And then Isaiah, you know, he's saying, man, I feel so unworthy because my eyes have seen the King of Glory. Woo, hallelujah. My eyes have seen the King of Glory. And that's when he asked for a coal. The angel brings a coal from the altar of God, touches his lips, and God says, you're worthy. And then he says, who shall I send for me? And Isaiah says, I'll go. Now, before this vision, if you would have asked Isaiah, how you doing? He said, man, I'm doing awesome. I'm God's man of power for the hour. You know what I'm saying? And then God showed up. Amen? How many times you think that you know everything, right? And then God shows up. And you go from, you know, oh, man, you just see the glory of God. Or you're in a place of difficulty. And you're down. But you know, you see Jesus through the word. Amen? And you're lifted up, El Elyon, the God who lifts up. So God wants us, this reality, glory to God, changed his life. And there are different types of visions. I mean, there are, in Acts 10, the Bible says Peter was in a trance. A trance is a type of vision. It's when your natural faculties are suspended. And I mean, God just has a hold of you because there's nothing to quench him. Amen. Peter, he had in his mind that the Gentiles would never, ever be saved. So God basically had to put him in a trance so he would hear what God was saying. Amen? And it's a type of vision. Of course, he saw the vision with the sheet and the different animals on it. And God saying, I made it clean. You know, the Gentiles are to come in. There are lower level visions. There's trances. There's higher level visions where the highest would be an open vision. Like John saw Jesus on the island of Patmos. It's just an open vision. And the New Testament, in the context of the discerning of spirits, is when God supernaturally causes you to be able to see into the spirit realm. You can see angels. You can see demons. You can see Jesus. And that's what the discerning of spirits are for. But even greater than that is the ability of your spirit to perceive. Jesus is in the house today. He was here in worship. You might not have seen him, amen, with your physical eyes, like with the discerning spirits, but you sensed him, you perceived him. Amen? Glory to God. All right. Now, we're sharing this because God wants us to enter into a place where the word, when you read it, it causes you to be able to enter in experientially to what you read. Amen? And Proverbs 18, you know, God says that you can run into his name. He said, my name is a strong tower that you run into. It's something in the spirit realm that, Jesus, you enter into. Glory to God. So when you read the word and when I read the word, God wants us to see it. In a way that, you know, the entrance of his word gives light. Psalm 119, 130. It's one thing to read the word. It's another thing that when you read the word, you see Jesus. Amen? You're not just reading about Jesus. You're seeing Jesus. The Bible says the Word is alive. Hebrews 4:12. Amen? So it's a different level, to be honest with you, of entering into. Glory to God. I remember one time I said God tricked me in the sense that he came to me and he said, I was just battling something. And he said, you know what? If you looked into the Bible right now and it just stood up, I mean in 3D, and everything was like 3D, the words just stood up on the page. He said, would that bless you? And I said, yeah, it would bless me. So I look at my Bible and it's no 3D. You know what I'm saying? It's just regular print. And I said, God, what'd you do? And he said, you know what? If that I gave you that experience where the word just literally stood up on the page, I mean, you would really be confident today in my word. It would be experiential. He said, I want you to see the word in your spirit as 3D, even though it doesn't stand up on this page in 3D. Amen? And, you know, that's what God wants. All of us can think about experiences that we've had with the Lord. Perhaps when we got saved, when we got baptized in the Spirit, perhaps when, you were used of God in a mighty way, when you saw a miracle. And I'm sure many times when our daughter Mary, when she was little, I think she was 5 years old or something, she had a growth on the side of her face, and Kathy and I prayed, but it just didn't seem to work. It wasn't God's fault. And we made, she had surgically removed. And when I went back to the post op, I mean, she must have had a roll of gauze in her head, man. You know, it's just like, and the doctor said that, starting to grow back. He said, it's not a good deal. And so I fasted 3 days and Kath was praying with me. And I gotta show you the third day I was in a cornfield not too far from here, up by the water tower, the university, and fire. I can still remember it like it was yesterday. Fire about the size of a 50-cent piece came in my right hand, and my fire. It was fire in my hand. It was fire. And so the Lord spoke to me and said, don't talk to anybody on the way down. I was probably like a mile away from her house. And so I didn't, and he said, lay your hands on her. And I did, and the fire went from my hand into her head, and she's perfectly healed. And I ran her up to Dr. Hoyt Sr., who was in Grove City, and he said, yeah, I'll verify. I mean, she's completely whole. And bottom line is this, it would be nice if every time I had a need, fire would go in my hand. Wouldn't that be nice in your hand? You know what I'm saying? That would be an awesome deal. You know what I'm saying? You wake up in the morning and God says, I want to let you know I love you. And there'll be fire in your left hand to know that I love you, fire in your right hand to do the works of God. Wouldn't that be nice every day? It's not going to happen. Okay. But because when they were in the promised land, they had, right? They had cloud by day, fire by night. Shoes didn't wear out. Nobody needed a haircut. I mean, it was just outwardly. Then God takes them into the promised land. There isn't any cloud by day. They'd use suntan lotion. You know what I'm saying? There's no fire by night. Then their shoes are wearing out. And they got to plant these little seeds. Man, to me, it looked like the promised land was there. When, you know what I'm saying? And when they didn't have to work for food or whatever. But the promised land is when it's from the inside out. Amen? When you're able to enter in, and I'm able to enter in, through the written word of God, amen, as it is a vision, glory to God. And it stands up through your spirit, and when you enter into the word of God, it's something that the same word that got you born again, the same word, hallelujah, will cause you to be strengthened. The same word that got you born again will cause life, amen, that come into your spirit, your mind, your body, your emotions, glory to God. Amen? Because the word of God is what we live by. Amen? Glory to God. So to me, that's maturity. Amen? Glory to Jesus. And that's why we've been born again. In John 3:3, Jesus said, you've been born again that you might see the kingdom. You might see the kingdom of God. And then John 3:5 says, you've been born again that you might enter into the kingdom. It's one thing to see the kingdom. It's another thing to enter into it. Amen. But you can't enter into what you don't see. How do you see it? First and foremost, through the word of God. Glory to Jesus. You see, what's awesome is that, man, I love that song we were singing. You know, that, you know, the fire of his love. Glory to God. That, here's what's so exciting, is that you, glory to God, the Holy Ghost is able to reign in you. You're a lightning rod for the Spirit of God. God wants us to see that, man, the fire of faith, heaven, glory to God, is in you. Yeah, his presence is heaven. Glory to God. His faith is heaven. His love is heaven. His hope is heaven. His strength is heaven. And the scripture says that the kingdom of God is within you. When Jesus said that, you know, Mark chapter 1, I believe it was verse 14, that, you know, preach the gospel of the kingdom of heaven. Matthew 10:7-8, go preach saying, right, the kingdom of heaven has come. Heal the sick, raise the dead, cast out demons. Amen. Heal the leper. Glory to God. Heaven is really in us. Glory to God. When heaven is in us, there is an ability from within to see the word as a vision. Glory to God. The devil will do everything he can to negate the word. So, and sometimes you don't feel like the word's working. Sometimes you can't see the word as a vision, but by faith, we need to say, man, the same word that saved me, that gave me birth, is the same word, glory to God, that's going to heal me, that's going to give me the ability to forgive that person that hurt me, that is going to cause me to enter into doing the works of God. How can you do the works of God unless you have the faith that Jesus had to do the works of God? Amen? So now we're entering into a place where it's exciting. Because remember when Jesus said, man, you can't be born again because unless, you know, you have new wineskins. You know, because before someone's born again, the Spirit of God can't indwell you because he can't indwell sin. Amen? But now that you've got a born-again spirit, man, a spirit, hallelujah, that's been born again, that's undefiled. Now the Holy Spirit, who is holy, obviously can indwell you. He who is joined to the Lord is one spirit with him. So his life can now become our life. Glory to Jesus. And so when we're in a place of trial, when we're in a place maybe we're fighting condemnation, maybe we're fighting sickness. Maybe we're just fighting the devil's trying to oppress and just come against you because he knows that your destiny is strong and you're going to take his head. So he's trying to intimidate. He's trying to negate, amen, what God has spoken. You know, in Mark 4, Jesus said, let's go to the other side. You know, to deliver the demoniac of Gadara. And as they're going over, we've shared this so many times, but it's such a powerful truth. I mean, the devil sent, you know, rain or whatever. The ship was sinking. They were dying. And Jesus rebuked, amen, the rain. And I'm sure the water went out of the ship. And said, peace be still. Glory to God. But you see, the devil, when he comes against you, he is a spirit being. We need to fight him in the spirit with spiritual weapons. Amen? Amen? You're not going to beat the devil with natural human wisdom. You're not going to be able to penetrate the devil with mental assent. It has to be with the faith of God. Amen? Amen? Glory to God. So God wants us to be excited. God wants us, even in the midst of trial, to enter into a place where the supernatural, glory to God, is natural. Glory to God. Amen. Go with me, if you would, to, I believe it's Luke chapter 7. I'm changing some things as I'm talking, but Luke chapter 7, I believe, is verse 15. Luke 7:15. Jesus. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Thank you. Thank you, Holy Ghost. Glory to God. Let's just see here. Let's start with, it says, and it came to pass the day after that they went into a city called Nain, and many of the disciples went with him, much people. So Jesus is being followed by many people. He's going into a city called Nain, which is a strong city, a large city, and he's going to take over that city. Amen? He is going to bring revival to that city. Glory to God. But let's read the next verses. Now when he came to the gate of the city, behold, there was a dead man being carried out, the only son of his mother. And she was a widow. And many people of the city were with her. Now here's what's interesting. You've got Jesus coming in with a large entourage of people to bring the kingdom of heaven. And the devil says, you know what? I'm going to meet you at the gates. The gates at those times was where confrontation came. You know, we have to make sure we don't let different things pass our gates into our house. Amen. Amen? So Jesus is coming through the gates, glory to God. They can't keep him from coming through the gates, but right at the gates, the devil meets Jesus. He says, you are the resurrection. You're the life. I am death. And right as Jesus, who is resurrection and life, is coming through the gates, the devil meets him with who he is. Wow. Young man. I mean, the mom's been through a lot. She's a widow. She's got one son. And he's dead, man. Wow. Now we got confrontation. We got supernatural versus supernatural. Glory to God. And this is what I want to encourage you. If you don't like battle, I tell you what, it's not going to be good. Amen? We have to love battle. Amen? We don't want to enter into battles that we shouldn't enter into. You know, you screaming at your neighbor and cursing him because his dog's barking in the night. Amen? That's not a battle of God. Amen? But we're talking battles where you're bringing the kingdom of heaven. Amen? Amen. And the devil is trying to keep heaven from coming. Glory to God. And he's trying to bring hell to you. Jesus. So here's what happens. Glory to God. And when the Lord saw, when he saw her, he had compassion on her. And said unto her, weep not, glory to God. Woo, hallelujah. Man, the love of God. Amen. I wrote down just some things from that song, that we were singing. You know, the love of God in my heart, the fire of God. So Jesus confronts the hatred of the enemy that killed her son with compassion, didn't he? Glory to guess who wins. Amen. Glory to God. And he said, and he came, he touched the bier, the coffin, and they stopped. And he said, young man, I say unto thee, arise. And he that was dead sat up and began to speak, and he delivered him to his mother. Now listen to this. And there came a fear on all. And they glorified God, saying, that a great prophet is risen up from among us, and God has visited his people. Glory to God. And this testimony of him went forth throughout all Judea and throughout all the region much about. When the enemy comes against you to attack you, he's there to cause you to think that he's going to win. Amen? And man, sometimes in your soul, it looks like he's going to win. You don't feel God. You don't sense God. That's where we have to mix our faith with the supernatural. Glory to God. The Word of God is fire.
Amen.
So when the Word of God is in you and you speak, fire will come forth from you, your words being confirmed by the Holy Ghost. You've got to fight, and I've got to fight the enemy with the supernatural. The Bible says in Jeremiah, my word is not like fire. Glory to God. Is it also not like a hammer that destroys the enemy? So what I'm sharing today is this, what God wants us to share is this. The entrance of His Word giveth light. What you believe is what you're going to see. What you believe is going to give you an image of what you really, really believe. Believing brings forth images. That's what God said in 2 Corinthians 10:3. Cast down images of harm. Well, God, man, we need to exalt images. Amen, a blessing. Glory to God. Amen. God's called us to be conformed to His image. Be not conformed to the image of this world. Amen. God wants the Word that causes us to see. But we have to enter in this way. Man, so when you read in the Bible, for example, Psalm 91, that God is going to protect you. Right? One of the most awesome psalms. It's just amazing, isn't it? Glory to God. Jesus. That should give you an image of Him protecting you. I'll never forget when I was a young Christian, I was an elder in a pretty large church. And I said many times, well, no more an elder than an astronaut, but they may have been an elder. I think I was 22 years old. But the pastor was really good. And I was assembly of God church, and he had come from Philadelphia. He shared testimony with me, and he said that he prayed for a young man that had had cerebral palsy, so he was exempt from military service. And it was at the time of Vietnam, but he was healed. So he went back to the draft board at the time and said, "I'm healed." So they said, "Okay, you know, you're going to be drafted." And the pastor got with him. Obviously, he was a young Christian. And said, "You will not be harmed. No matter what's around you, you will not be harmed." And the man's testimony was, I mean, bombs exploded around me. And I was in places you wouldn't believe. But I came back because of Psalm 91. But he said, I had an image, amen, of wholeness. What the mind of your spirit should affect this mind, amen. Glory to God. But the image of protection came from the Word like a vision. See, the Word should cause you and I to see, glory to God, in the mind of our spirits what's taking place in the spirit realm. And sometimes you can't see it in the physical realm. Glory to God, your natural mind might be giving you problems, but you need to tell your natural mind that the mind of your spirit, glory to God, is the key, is truth. And the natural mind, glory to God, it is a servant of your spirit. Amen. Your soul is never meant to be above your spirit. Your mind, your emotions, your willpower, your personality is a servant of your spirit. Amen. Glory to God. And your mind goes haywire sometimes. Mine does. Man, it's like, what about this? What about this? What about this? You know what I'm saying? It's like, ah. And God's saying, look to the mind of your spirit. Cause the natural mind to come in subjection to it and see what my word says is true. Glory to God. So man, you got one person, say they're both Christians, and you know what? And they know that they're going to be in a difficult situation, and they know Psalm 91, but the natural mind takes over and says that we're going to die. You know, Kathy and I, you know, I'm ordained from a very mission-oriented church. Man, we have, Day Spring, people going into every part of the world. And I mean where you can die real easily. You can die real easily. But the bottom line is, and one friend said, you know, I'm going to die there. And I said, God, he said, I'm going to be a martyr. I said, God's not calling you to be a martyr. God's calling you to live. He said, well, I see myself dying. I said, well, that's not God telling you you're dying. The Word says He's going to protect you. Now, there is martyrdom, and that's a whole different deal. But the bottom line is this. So now, when He's going into a place where people have been killed, glory to God, what's His image? It's one of protection. Man, when I first got saved, there's a real precious lady from China, Nora Lim. One of my best friends was involved in her ministry. And, man, she's pregnant. She's 19 years old, and she's in front of a firing squad, man. I think, and that was one of the first sermons I ever heard as a new believer, and she came to our church. And I think she said there's 9 people. She's in front of a firing squad for real, and pregnant, 19 years old. There's a book about her. And they all shoot, and nobody hits. And then they run. Glory to God. Someone says, well, that's her. No, that's the word.
Amen.
Her testimony, she said, I had a vision through the word that I'm going to be okay. How's that possible? It's supernatural. Amen. We need to see the supernatural. Man, but when you share the gospel with somebody, you and I need to see fire. Woo, burning up their excuses.
Amen.
Rather than be intimidated by their success.
Amen.
Man, I'm guilty of this at times. Man, you're going to share the gospel with a banker. Man, you don't got a dollar in your account. He's got $1 million in his account. And you're telling him about Jesus and, you know, bringing him prosperity. Amen? And you got an image of him thinking, who are you? When you're in his bank to take out a loan. You know what I'm saying? But you've got to see fire.
Amen.
Of the gospel going from your mouth into him. Glory to God. Burning up the lies that he's a success when the natural mind says he is. And the Bible says he's on his way to hell. And he is the last thing he is a success. Are you understanding what God's saying? I know this is strong. But you know what? Life is strong. Amen? Life is not a game. Glory to God. You've got to see fire burning up the stubble in your life and in my life, burning up the unbelief. See, it's one thing to quote the word, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me, who infuses the very life of Jesus Christ into me. But if you don't see it working, changing the anger in you into peace, if you don't see it giving you the faith of God, if you don't see it, it's not going to work. I've said this many times. I can get a parrot, you know, to say, you know, my God supplies all of my crackers according to his riches and glory in Christ Jesus. And he can say that nonstop. Amen? It doesn't mean the parrot's going to get faith. Because a parrot doesn't have a spirit to get faith. Amen? We got these two little, they look like parakeets, but they're called something else and they're little parrots. They're supposed to talk. They don't talk much. But I'm trying to get, I've said this many times, for someone to walk in, you click your, you know, hand and just say, you know, and the birds say, don't be stupid, get saved. Don't be stupid, get saved. Amen? And Kathy has quenched the spirit and not let me do that. But bottom line is, it's what, see, the Bible says you will be what you see. Not just what you say. Sure, life is in the power. Life and death is in the power of your tongue. But when you speak it, you have to see it working through your spirit. I'm not saying through your mind, through these natural eyes. Because sometimes, man, you don't feel it. It doesn't look like it's working. How do I know it's working? Because the same word that saved me and caused me to be born again is the same word that laughs me. Glory to God. Amen? Ooh, hallelujah. The devil says, that won't work. The devil says, look, in natural eyes. It's not working. And I got to say, you know what? I'm a product of this word. I know I'm born again through the incorruptible seed of the word of God. And I know this word's working. And my spirit knows it. Sometimes my soul is a little slow in catching up to my spirit. Amen? So I got to tell it over and over again, it's working until it gets it. That's what David said, don't be downcast, O my soul. Believe thou in God, for he will deliver you, deliver me. Amen? Obviously, his soul wasn't getting it. Sometimes you got to speak loud to your soul. Sometimes you have to keep speaking to your soul. See, sometimes, a lot of times, it's not the devil that's a problem, it's your soul. Jesus. Trying to tell you what's going on in your life. Again, the soul is meant to be your servant. It's not meant to be the gauge of truth in your life. Man, your soul's going to be up and down at times. Man, my emotions can be up and down. I ate too much pepperoni on the pizza. You know what I'm saying? Can affect my emotions. That didn't have anything to do with unbelieving coming to pass. It just means I had too much pizza with pepperoni. Seriously. I stayed up too late and I'm tired. You ever get tired? And man, it's like, whew, you don't feel like nothing's true. But that's when you need to take a nap like Jesus did on the ship. Amen? Sometimes the best thing you can do is take a nap. Glory to God. Amen? See, it's not just what you do, it's how you do it. It's not just quoting the word. It's quoting with the word, glory to God, with a view to righteousness. In the book of Hosea 10:12, it says, sow with a view to righteousness. What's that mean? It means when you sow, you're looking up, believing what you're sowing is going to come to pass. Man, I believe in confession. I believe in speaking the word of God. But there's people that die speaking. There's people that never get delivered of sin that speak it because they never see what they're speaking coming to pass. Man, in 2 Kings 2, Elijah says to Elijah, man, I want a double portion of your spirit. What did Elijah say? If you see me, wouldn't you go? If you see me, then you'll have. He's talking about the eyes of your spirit. He didn't see the chariots of fire in the natural mind. He saw it supernaturally because he had sowed right. Glory, amen. 2 Kings 2, man, he stayed with Elijah through thick and thin. He was a servant. I feel like Lord's saying this. There are so many Christians that love God that's so right. And they quote the right scriptures. But man, it's like there's no expectation. There's more images of evil than there is good. Glory to God. I was at a pretty large church about 1,200 people. And, you know, I shared the gospel, and it was good, and a good church, very prophetic, intercessory church, really not a word of faith church, but very good church. And so the Lord told me, so a lot of people come forward. You can't pray for everybody. There's a couple hundred people came forward. And so I went to one guy, and the Lord said, go to this guy, and I sensed that he was struggling with pornography. And I, of course, didn't say anything, and I put my hand on his hand, and there was an elder in the church. The pastor wasn't there. So the main elder comes down. He grabs a hold of my hand and says, don't pray for him. I'm thinking, gee. He says, he went down to the altar for the last 10 years thinking this. 10 years every Sunday getting prayed for to get rid of pornography. And I said, well, Lord told me to pray. I said, you stay with me. So I prayed for him and Jesus came and helped him. But here's what I said. I said, it's good to get prayer. Jesus will meet you and help you. But I said, I gave him some very simple scriptures. I said, I want you to read these scriptures, you know, Philippians 4:13 and different scriptures like that. Philippians 1:21, for me to live is Christ. And I said, when you read these scriptures, I just want you by the Holy Ghost, not by the natural. Just thank God and just see, glory to God. Let the eyes of your spirit see your freedom. Let the mind of your spirit just take over. Glory to God. And I say it's about 6 weeks later, the elder called back to apologize. He said, because I told him to be the accountability partner for this man that you don't want to pray for. And I think that's a greater miracle than the deliverance from pornography. So he didn't like this guy at all. And he called back, he said, I apologize. He said, you know, that man is walking in a spirit of purity in a way that I never thought was possible. And he's been free ever since. Glory to God. And he's now an elder in that church. Amen. Glory to God. But what was the deal? It wasn't just praying. Do you understand? It wasn't just praying. It's entering into the scriptures. Glory to God. Ooh, to take you over. Glory to God. How many know when Peter was in a trance, he was taken over? He couldn't say to God, but. Because his mouth was shut. Amen? Glory to God. His soul couldn't speak. Glory to God. His mind was taken over with the thoughts of God. His mouth was shut. The only thing he could see was what God presented to him. Amen? Amen. And he laid his life on the line by sharing the gospel with the Gentiles. I mean, that was something you did not do. We won't get into that whole scenario. But the bottom line is this. Here's what's exciting. The entrance of his word, Psalm 119:130. Give it light. Glory to God. Hallelujah. So let's use a few examples of this. Glory to God. So I forget. I love Jesus, of course, is our main example. We gave the example of Elijah and Elisha. This is a book by Smith. This says Smith Wigglesworth on faith. I just like this guy a lot. You know, and he ministered in the 1900s. I think he died in the late 1950s. He was from England. By trade, he was a plumber. Never learned to read till he was in his 20s. His wife, Polly, did most of the preaching. And he was somebody that, couldn't read. His wife tried to get him to speak in front of people. He couldn't do it. And he got baptized in the Spirit, and that changed things. But then he, very humble man. And I think there's been, 20 people raised from the dead. And he said 1 million people saved, and they said up to 1 million people healed. He spoke to, he's from England, but he spoke to, somehow they put him before the 9 Supreme Court justices when he came to the States. And they said he couldn't spell real well, couldn't speak, but the anointing came on him. And the Supreme Court justice says, we've never heard a man speak like this. Glory to God. But the reason I'm sharing on that is that he's the one that came up with the quote, I can't enter into God through emotions. God said it, I believe it, that settles it. Amen. God said it. Amen. Sometimes it's easy to minimize God with your soul, isn't it? Your soul thinks it's a lot bigger than it is. Amen? Because it's used to getting its own way. You know, I want to eat those 6 donuts. And our spirit says, that's not good. And our soul says, shut up. Gong, 6 donuts. Amen? You eat 6 donuts every day. You know what I'm saying? Your soul's going to get to thinking it can eat it when it wants it. Amen? So, glory to God. I believe it. God said it. I believe it. That settles it. Glory to God. Really, God said it, that settles it. Amen. Glory to God. But he shares that he was ministering to a pastor, another pastor he was doing some meetings for, and God didn't have any legs. And the Spirit of God just rose up within him. Glory to God. And see, he didn't quench it with his soul. And in those days, they didn't have, sophisticated, limbs like today, the artificial limbs. And but he just looked at him and he said, go get a pair of shoes in the morning for your new legs. And the pastor, he went to bed and God spoke to him and said, that was the word of the Lord to you. So the pastor gets to the shoe shop. This is in London, I believe, Yorkshire. And he's excited and he gets in there and he asks for a pair of shoes. Glory to God. And goes and does what he can, no limb, and a whole limb appears. He not only came out with a new pair of shoes, but a new pair of legs. Amen? Amen. Lord God. Now, I said that to say this. Smith Wigglesworth shared this. When the word came from him, glory to God, he said, my mind wanted to stop it, my natural mind. But then the mind of my spirit took. And he said, I knew that I knew that I knew. Because the eyes of my spirit saw those legs in the spirit realm. Glory to God. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us with all spiritual blessings, Ephesians 1:3, in the heavenly places. See, the key is this. We know the blessings are there. It's getting them from there down to here. Amen? But God wants us to understand what's in the heavenlies is in your heart. And what's in your heart as you speak it, seeing, expecting, will come to pass. And we'll say that again. What's in the heavenlies, your blessings are in the heavenlies in the man Christ Jesus. Ephesians 1:3, 1 Timothy 2:5. How do you get it from there to here? It's understanding. through the Word of God, man. What's in the heavenlies gets in your heart. And as you speak, seeing expectation, when I'm talking about seeing expectantly, what's in the heavenlies through the Word of God gets in you and now will manifest on the earth. There's no separation. See, in America, we separate everything, don't we? Really, we separate everything. And God just says it is, and when, it is what it is. It's here. All right? Yeah, I shared with you, a real nice lady, she loved the Lord, and she came up to me. She said, I'm so confused. She said, I don't know if I'm in a good will of God, acceptable will of God, perfect will of God, permissive will of God. And I said, lady, you got me confused. And I just said, you love God, he loves you, just believe. Amen?
Amen.
Glory to God. Let not the simplicity that is in Christ corrupt your minds.
Hallelujah.
Amen. God puts it in one place and it's whole. It's together. Glory to God. What's in the Word gets in your spirit. What's in your spirit takes over your soul. Glory to God. And what's in your spirit causes you to know and to see. And as you speak, knowing, seeing, the Holy Ghost will confirm you, will confirm me. Amen. Not because of who we are, but because of who he is. Amen. In us. And him giving us his righteousness. So now we're in a place, man, where we're, you know, we're excited. So what's the challenge? The challenge is that, first of all, to stay in the Spirit. Because sometimes, man, you're going out to minister the gospel. Man, I had a good friend of mine. Man, he's ministering the gospel, and I'm talking to him, and I'm helping disciple him. And he's on a mission trip in a real bad place, and he gets beat up pretty good. And he comes back, and he won souls, but he got beat up pretty good. And he said, what's up with that? And I said, well, all I know is this. You came against the devil, devil came against you, and you won souls, so he won the battle. We won the war, but we lost the battle. I said, next time we're going out. And he went with me to a real bad place in a city. And it was as bad as where he was in a different country. It was bad. And you have to really hear from God. And it looked like we were going to get harmed, to be honest with you. And I looked at him and smiled. He looked at me and I said, we're going to trust Jesus. I said, I see victory. I see no harm. Glory to God. But this is how we need to enter in. One of the guys that discipled me, I'll never forget. I was dating Kathy. We're in the residence hall. You know, I had my arm around her. And I'm just like, you know, life is good. And the guy discipling me, he's a pastor in an interracial church up Farrell Way. And it's like 11:30 at night. He came and he said, the Lord spoke to me that you and I are supposed to go to this bar. And it's a really bad bar. And we're going to stand up on the pool table and share the gospel. And Jesus is going to come and help us. I said, Jesus is going to help you. I said, this is true. I'm only, you know, I'm young in the Lord. I ain't going nowhere. But I went. And Lord Jesus. So we get there. He said, I forgot to tell you. I'm going to be praying and you're the one on the pool table. I'm seriously.
What?
And I'm saying, so I get up there and I'm shaking like a leaf. This is a true story. And, you know, it's mostly it's an African-American bar. And I'm up there as the white kid that doesn't know nothing from nothing. You know what I'm saying? And he said, angels are here. Angels are here. I see angels protecting. I'm thinking, I don't see nothing. You know what I'm saying? All I see is getting beat up, you know, on this stupid pool table. It's true. He said, I see angels. And I said, you're down here. I'm on the pool table. Seriously, he's talking to me while I'm on the pool table. So I already said, just open your mouth. There's angels here. I said, all right, there's angels here. All right. I just started sharing and Jesus came. He really did.
Amen.
Jesus came and helped us. And it was really good. And he knew the area better than me. He actually knew some of the people there. But when we left there, I think it was like 1:32 in the morning. I said, man, when you saw angels, I didn't see nothing. He said, but I saw them through the Word of God, through my spirit. I knew when he spoke to me, he was speaking truth. You know what I'm saying? Like 2 Kings, you know, that the young Elisha said to the young prophet, I see chariots of fire. And but it was a lesson, glory to God. Amen? Sometimes when you're younger, you do crazy things. Amen? Sometimes when you're older, you do crazy things. But I want to conclude by saying this. The Lord wants us to understand Life is meant to be good. But in the natural, there's a lot of hell around it. But God says, I will cause you to prosper in the midst of your enemies. Glory to God. I will cause you to prosper in the midst of your enemies. To close, I want to pray that song. Can we put that on? I want us to sing this song. I want you to see where the presence of God is, your need is met. Okay? Amen. When it says, you know, your presence is heaven. It's your victory over familiar sin. It's my victory over sickness, or your victory over sickness. It's my victory over the fear of rejection. I just believe the fire of God is going to be ministered to us, okay? And also, I had a last name, Dodds, D-O-U-D-S. If that means something to somebody, after we're done, come up for prayer. But let's just enter in and just let Jesus come to us, okay? The most exciting thing about this is it's for you. It's for me. Because Jesus is in us. Amen?
Amen.
So let's just enter in right now. Praise God. Forget about everything else. Glory to God. And let's just receive this in Jesus' name. Amen? Glory to God. Hallelujah, Jesus. Thank you, Lord.
Stops, it rages on. Your love is like a river. rock that I am standing on. Your love is like a river flowing from my heart.
We praise you, Father. We praise you, Father God. We're not just human, we're fire. We thank you, Lord God, we're not wood, hay, and stubble. God, we thank you, we're gold. We thank you, Father, that the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is in us to life us. Glory to God, that caused the life of Jesus, which is fire, to reign in faith and love, consecration, strength, and victory, and fruitfulness with souls. Lord, we give you praise and worship. Lord, we need you every day. Help us, God, to enter in, to take time just to sit down and confess the word by the grace of the Holy Ghost in seeing and expecting. Because what we see, we will be. And the entrance of your word is like a vision. It giveth light to see. Lord, help us never to speak without seeing. Ooh. Help us, oh God, to enter into a place where we know that the blood of Jesus is so powerful. It causes fire to be our life. But we vow to give you the glory. Help us not to be intimidated by the enemy, by the fear of man, by circumstances, but to understand that fire, it will burn up the fire, the counterfeit fire of the enemy, even as you died to give us victory. We give you praise and worship, God. Lord, boy, I just sense Jesus. I really do sense Jesus big time. Whew, man. You know, it's interesting. You know, we didn't, you know, Michelle and Ada coming because Chris is here and got Bert to take him to the ER. So all this is kind of off the cuff in some ways. But God's here in a mighty way. Amen. Gene, would you close us in prayer if you would? And if I'll tell you what, if you need prayer, just come up. Word of knowledge, Dodd, Spit, I think it's D-O-U-D-S. But I want to encourage you to come to the, again, to the seminar with Terry Smith. Invite somebody. Amen. It's for free. And I just want to encourage us. Amen. During this week, tell yourself, call up somebody and just tell them, man, the fire of God reigns in your spirit. The fire of God is your life. Amen. Someone was saying they had a great need, and they do. And I was thinking, man, does any one of us have any lesser need? How much do each of us need the life of Jesus to be our life? Amen? Glory to God, we'd all be destroyed. Amen. June, if you'd pray for us, and then get excited. Tell somebody that the fire reigns in you. Woo. Is life. Amen.